Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this special virtual concert presented by the Living Harmony Concert Series. My name is Eric Tuan, and I serve as the Director of Music at Christ Episcopal Church in Los Altos and the Artistic Director of the Piedmont East Bay Children's Choir. It's so great to see you all this evening. Thanks for joining us for this virtual concert. Tonight's program is a journey through 500 years of organ music. You may be wondering where the organ is. It will appear shortly. All the music has been recorded over the past 6 months while we've been in sheltering in place. In my work at Christ Church, I've been recording some new organ music every week to be used in our liturgies. So you'll hear my favorites from that, as well as some other organ music recorded freshly for this program. A few housekeeping things. First of all, welcome to Zoom. Please make sure that you stay muted unless you'd like to ask a question. You can find the mute button in the bottom left-hand corner of your screen. If you'd also like to leave any comments or questions in the chat, you can use that as well. The chat is at the bottom of the screen next to the participants window. Okay. Second, if you can, we recommend that you use headphones to listen to the concert. The organ is such a complex instrument to capture the sound of, and of course, it's always best to hear it in the real space. But you'll hear it better through headphones or through any, you know, Bose speakers or whatever else you may have than through your computer or phone speakers. So we'll start tonight's program with two songs from the Mulliner book. I'll be offering some commentary on this guided tour as we go along. So the Mulliner book is one of the oldest sources of English organ music. It's held in the British Library, and it was compiled between 1545 and 1570 by someone named Thomas Mulliner. And we know absolutely nothing about Thomas Mulliner except that he was the organist at Corpus Christi College, Oxford. As you might expect, as a chapel organist, the manuscript of Mulliner's music focuses primarily on sacred music, so there are lots of works based on the chant for the pre-Reformation Sarum Rite, and transcriptions of music by leading composers of the Tudor era, people like Thomas Tallis and John Tavener. But of course, there is also a fun side to this manuscript, and it has 20 secular pieces in it. And among those are keyboard arrangements of two very popular dances from Tudor England. One is called La Bunette, and the other is called La Dunicella. You'll hear that the Tudor organ itself is very different from the organ that we think of nowadays. It was a small instrument. It was tuned differently in Pythagorean tuning, and it only had one manual, so no pedal board. It's much smaller than we think of nowadays. You can see a wonderful construction of a replica by Hupilo and Rapaski and Stanford's Memorial Church. But one of the features of the Tudor organ was that they really loved these bright, sort of brassy and reedy stops, especially the Vox Virginis. So in my registration, my choice of stops, you'll hear a little bit of my attempt to imitate that sound. So here are two dances from the Mulliner book.
Thank you.
We'll now travel a few hundred years and head east to Germany to hear two pieces by the young Johann Sebastian Bach. So the first piece, Herr Gott, nun schließ den Himmel auf, is taken from a collection called the Neumeister Manuscripts, which are one of the great discoveries of modern musicology. This is a compilation of organ works by a sort of little-known German organist named Johann Gottfried Neumeister. It ended up in the library at Yale University, and in 1985, some musicologists who were looking through it found out that it contained 31 works by Johann Sebastian Bach that had not been heard before. The pieces fill a gap in our knowledge of Bach's career, and they date from his teenage years when he was working at the ducal courts of Arnstadt and Mühlhausen. So you can hear in this music a teenager sort of finding his way, hearing all these wonderful influences from the musicians around him and assimilating them. This is an example of a chorale prelude. So this is something that Bach would play before the hymns were sung to introduce the melody of the hymn. The hymn is called Herr Gott, nun schließ den Himmel auf, and it's a text for the Feast of the Presentation, when Simeon sees the baby Jesus and is finally able to say, "I can go in peace now. I've seen God's will realized." So Bach wrote two settings of this. The later setting is very serene. It approaches death with sort of a calm, gentle feeling and a gently knocking pedal part. This one is angry. It starts with these two big chords, and then a big echo, a gentle echo, and then bursts out into the chorale melody. So it's a big sort of passionate piece. I hope you enjoy Herr Gott, nun schließ den Himmel auf.
Thank you.
As much as we love and appreciate Bach nowadays, he was not considered to be a model employee by his employers. He got in trouble quite a lot. He was actually jailed for threatening a bassoonist with a duel on the town square because the bassoonist did not meet his exacting performance expectations. One of Bach's most egregious experiences was taking a vacation that lasted 4 months instead of 3 weeks. And the goal of this vacation was to walk all the way to the northern port city of Lübeck to hear Dietrich Buxtehude, one of the legendary and most wonderful organists of the time. Buxtehude loved to show off his prowess on the pedal board, the keyboard that organists play with their feet. And Bach was certainly influenced by that and wanted to show off his virtuosic technique. You'll hear a little bit of that in our next piece, the Prelude and Fugue in C minor, BWV 549. It opens with a very dramatic pedal solo played just by the feet, and then the prelude moves into a chain of suspensions in what's called the durezza style, hardness. It's called that way because of the harshness of the sort of resulting dissonances. You'll hear sort of a wonderful chain of tension and release. So I'll play a little bit of that for you on the piano. Wonderful tension there. And then you'll hear the fugue with a very short, sort of simple subject. And you'll hear that passed off between all the hands and eventually enjoying a triumphant entry in the pedals. Now, Bach was not, this music was thought to be too progressive for the church. So he was reprimanded for the curious variations, unquote, and many strange notes that he used. So I hope you enjoy these strange notes and wonderful variations.
Thank you.
Nothing like Bach. Now we're going to hear a little bit about the wonderful instrument that we are blessed with at Christ Church. Paul Cajola, our resident expert and caretaker of the organ, is here. Thank you for joining us, Paul. And I'm going to just ask a few questions. Paul, would you mind telling us a little bit about the organ specifications? Just how big is this instrument?
Well, this instrument has 31 rings, I believe. No, 30 rings.
Paul, you'll want to lean in close to the computer just to make
I'm
sure we
so
hear
far
you.
away. I've got to get a better mic for this computer. Anyway, this thing has 31 rings. It has 1,837 pipes in it, and there are also four electronic bass lower octave extensions. That's the size of it.
All right, wonderful. And I understand the instrument was originally built in 1975 to the specifications of Vicky Riley, who was the Christchurch organist at the time. Could you tell us a little bit about that original instrument?
Yeah, the original instrument was built in 1975. I think the dedicatory recital was in February of 1976, and the it had what did it have? It had 14 ranks. Yes, I think originally it had a little less, but
So about half the size of the current
it's
instrument.
about half the size. And in fact, it started out a little smaller than that. And was added to had two ranks added to it in 1981, and in 1987 they added that wonderful horizontal trumpet thing, which runs on a
And
wind pressure that it has no business doing, and
we'll
that's why
hear a
it's
little bit of that later.
oh good.
Come on.
All right, 61 pipes. A rank is 61 pipes.
Right. And then you are a part of the large sort of remodel that the organ undertook in 2005 that brought it to its current size.
Oh yes. I spent many happy hours, often at 2 or 3 in the morning with Peter Stolzkus, who's changed his name to Burton actually by now. But we actually doubled the size of the thing. We shuffled pipes all around, repurposed them. The man who built this was Paul Salen, and he also ran a pipe rescue business. And we have one small set of pipes that came from the First Christian Science Church in Los Angeles, and we have which was built in 1912. We've got those pipes, and there's a whole bunch of other things. I could bore you for hours with this, but there's a clarinet that everybody seems to like the sound of. Actually, came from a chapel, Winchester College in England, which was made in 1908. So we got pipes from everywhere. The thing I didn't tell you, Eric, was that in the process of this, we took out a whole row of seats from the choir loft and moved the great organ forward 4 feet so that we could put all the rest of the pipes in.
Wonderful.
And then the original organ was all electric. There was no electronics in it. It just had 900 wires going from the console, about 900, to the pipe chamber. And that's how the keys got to the pipes. Since we got the organ, and there were also no couplers, and I guess we could have a description of what couplers do. Couplers let the organist play on one keyboard the stops that are dedicated to another. This is basically what happens. And the original organ had none of those, so it was very limited in what an organist could do.
Thank you, Paul. It's just great to hear a little bit of the history. And I love the fact, especially, that the organ has pipes from so many places. I see here we have some, there are some pipes from a Murray Harris in 1912 and from a Aeolian Skinner organ built in 1964 that have all found new homes in our instrument, which is wonderful.
And of course, we replaced all the electrical stuff with electronics. Instead of 900 wires going from the console to the pipe chamber, we now have one high-speed electrical cable, digital cable that carries the whole thing. It's actually 100 feet long. We could move the console out from where it is if we need to.
Oh, excellent. All right. Well, thank you, Paul. And I guess speaking of organ building, the next set of our pieces is from one of the golden eras of organ building, which is 19th century France. There was a very famous organ builder named Aristide Cavaillé-Coll, and folks who opened his organs included Louis-James Alfred Lefebure-Wely, who we're about to hear a piece from, and Théodore Dubois, who we're also going to hear a piece from. So he, Cavaillé-Coll, innovated by building a family of stops to imitate orchestral instruments like the clarinet or the strings, modifying the swell pedal and allowing for higher wind pressures. So really letting the organ be a symphonic and sort of orchestral instrument. So we're going to hear a piece by Lefebure-Wely, his Offertoire in G minor, that demonstrates those exciting new tonal resources of the instrument.
Thank you.
One of the most characteristic French forms of organ music is the organ mass and the use of improvisation to highlight particular liturgical actions during the course of a mass. One of the most important moments in the service is the elevation, when the host is lifted as part of the Eucharistic service. So we're going to hear some music written for that moment by Louis Vierne, who was the organist at the legendary Parisian Church of Notre Dame for 37 years, maybe more than that, part of a long tradition of blind organists. And this is a subdued piece, a quiet piece, but with some really wonderful, slippery, chromatic, harmonic motion. Apologies. Give me one moment for the technical difficulties. And of course, it wouldn't be an organ recital without one of the French toccatas that are so central to the organ repertoire. These are pieces that are meant to be virtuoso show pieces. Of course, the most famous is by Vidor. But this one is by Théodore Dubois, who's little known today except for his organ music, although he did win the Prix de Rome, which was the biggest accolade for French musicians at the time. So this is his toccata in G, which sort of unusually has a wonderful reflective slow section in the middle. We'll now travel to the Americas to explore the work and music of the United States. And among the music here that is unique is the film music tradition, which influenced the composer Florence Price, whose music we're about to hear. Florence Price was born in Little Rock, Arkansas, and she was the first African-American composer to have her work performed by a major symphony. African-American woman, I'm sorry. She was a child prodigy and studied at the New England Conservatory when she was very young, and eventually made her way to Chicago, which was where her symphony in E minor was premiered by the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. In addition to her work as a composer, Price served as an organist for silent film screenings, and you'll hear a little bit of that influence in this short piece, A Pleasant Thought. Some of the wonderful schmaltzy harmonies and soaring melodies that we associate with the film music world.
Thank you.
We'll now turn to a piece by the composer George Walker, one of my favorite American composers of the 20th and 21st centuries. He was composing all the way until his death at the age of 96. Walker's career was marked by many firsts. He was the first Black composer to win a Pulitzer Prize for music, the first Black graduate of Curtis, and the first Black instrumentalist to play with the Philadelphia Orchestra, among others. He was also a child prodigy, giving his first public recital at 14 and attending Oberlin the year after. And he was able to study with Samuel Barber at Curtis and Rudolf Serkin, the pianist. And then he went to Paris to study with Nadia Boulanger, the legendary French pedagogue who's taught so many of the American composers of the 20th century. I highly recommend listening to his Lyric for Strings, which is a gorgeous orchestral piece. This is an organ piece called A Prayer, an Offertory. It's a very rich piece. It's a sort of intricate tapestry of all these independent polyphonic lines that get woven together into the shimmering texture. And it's dedicated to the memory of Walker's maternal grandmother, Malvina King, whom he had a special connection with. She escaped from slavery after losing two husbands to the brutality of the institution. And so this piece is dedicated to her memory.
Thank you.
And now we'll turn to the 21st century to hear a piece by the composer and organist Brenda Portman, who's from Cincinnati. She's won many national and international organ competitions and has written a march on the Old 100th Psalm tune, one of the most enduringly popular melodies, especially in the Protestant tradition. It was first used in the Genevan Psalter, a metrical psalter developed by John Calvin to encourage congregational singing of the Psalms. So this is a delightful march on Old 100th by Brenda Portman. We'll close this evening's program with a transcription of an orchestral work for the organ. The rich sonorities and very tonal colors of the instrument make it an ideal instrument for transcribing and or adapting orchestral music, which of course was how most symphonic music was first encountered, in the 18th and 19th centuries through some sort of keyboard transcription. This final piece is an arrangement of the Grand March from Verdi's opera Aida, which depicts the triumphal entry of the Egyptian army into the city of Thebes. These were very popular in 19th century operas because of the pageantry and massive crowd scenes and all the wonderful things you could display on the stage. The arrangement we'll hear is by the English organist and music editor Christopher Morris, and you can hear the use of the trompette en chamade, the horizontal trumpets that you can see sort of sticking out above the top of the instrument. There's a little bit of clipping on this one, unfortunately, just because of the volume of the trumpets.